Hi, my name is Pat Trimby. I'm EBSD Product Manager at Oxford Instruments Nano Analysis. And in this short video, we're going to look at how to measure grain size using EBSD. So we're starting within AZtec, and we're showing a forescatter image of a recrystallized austenitic stainless steel. And the first consideration that we need to think about is the measurement step size that is required to resolve adequately the grains in our sample. And for that, I would refer you to another video focusing on the selection of step size in EBSD measurements. So we've analyzed this particular sample, and we can look at the results of the analysis by switching to the construct map stage. So here we can see the basic information, the pattern quality, the orientation and phase maps, and we can look at some phase statistics. However, if we want to look at grain size within the AZtec software, we need to switch from the map mode to the data analysis mode. Here we can see that we have a number of choices of what we can do in the data analysis mode. We can clean up the data, we can go into the grain analysis mode, or we can look at the reclassify phase, which is a licensed option. I've gone straight into the grain analysis mode, but it is important when doing a grain analysis that the data has been cleaned up sufficiently so that a reliable grain detection can occur. So we're here already looking at clean data, and straight away the software is showing me a grain list, is showing me the grain statistics and histograms for the individual parameters. What's important is to look at the settings that we can define for our grain size detection. So we have the minimum pixels per grain, and the recommended default there is 10 pixels, and that is what is accepted in some of the international standards. We have the grain detection angle, so this is the threshold angle above which will be considered as a grain boundary. And the grain detection follows a flood fill process. So here we can see how this flood fill process works. We define the threshold disorientation, or what we're classifying as a grain boundary, and then the software will start at the top left of each newly defined region that is not included in another grain, and it will start to fill out using a flood fill algorithm pixel by pixel, and gradually it'll fill up and reach the limits that are bounded by this threshold disorientation until it's classified the individual grains, and it'll do that for every grain within our data set. So if we switch back to AZtec and we go back to the settings, a typical default grain detection angle would be somewhere around about 10 degrees, but in some materials we might use a little bit lower than that, perhaps down to 5 or 7.5 degrees. We also have an option called grain boundary completion, and once again we'll look at a schematic to understand what exactly that does. So boundary completion or boundary closure is explained within this slide. So here we're looking at an orientation map of a recrystallized magnesium sample, and if we look in the central dark blue grain, we can see that within the upper part of that grain we have a typical low angle boundary or subgrain boundary with a disorientation of about 6 degrees. So we wouldn't normally want to separate this grain into two separate grains. This is all part of the same grain, but it has a subgrain included within it. However, down at the bottom right of the same grain, we can see that there's a boundary which has got a disorientation above 10 degrees as shown by the black line, and then it's got a couple of segments where that disorientation dips below the 10 degrees. And we would normally consider this right-hand more purple colored grain to be considered as a separate grain, and it just happens to have a similar orientation, and so the boundary is in places just below 10 degrees. With the normal flood fill algorithm, all of these three domains will be picked out as the same grain. If we include the boundary closure, what the software will do is consider whether it should cut off some of those boundaries. So for this upper subgrain boundary, it makes a decision that this should be included as part of the same grain. But for the lower right grain, it closes the boundary off and separates the two grains. And so they're measured as separate grains, as we would if we were looking at them by eye. So back in AZtec, once again we go to the settings, we can consider the zero solutions as a grain, and we can disregard special boundaries. And here this allows us to specify a boundary, load a default cubic relationship, or load from the coincident site lattice file. And in this particular case, what we've told it to do is to ignore the sigma 3 CSL boundaries, and these are characterized by 60 degrees around 111 axis and with a deviation of 5 degrees. So it's important in twinned materials that we exclude these special boundaries to give a true measure of the grain size. And then we get our grain list, we get our statistics here, so we can see the mean, maximum, minimum, standard deviation. And down at the bottom we see an ASTM grain size number. And you can see that's 8.7, and you can see that's the ASTM E2627 grain size standard. The exclamation mark here warns us that that particular standard requires that the minimum number of pixels per grain should be more than 100. And we have set it in the settings to be more than 10. More than 100 is a very high setting, and to get an accurate grain size measurement with that, we would need to have a very, very small step size. And so, in general, we will set it to a minimum of 10 pixels per grain, and we will have this this warning signal. We can also see the distributions of a number of the different parameters as shown by scrolling down this slider in the bottom right hand corner. So we can do very quick and easy grain size measurements within the AZtec platform itself, but of course we can also do that in our AZtecCrystal data processing platform. So I'm switching to AZtecCrystal. Here we see the same data set, it's already been cleaned up, and we're seeing the orientation map with the twin boundaries. And if I switch to the grain size viewing mode, once again we have very similar information. Here we see the grain size settings on the right hand side, we see the grain list, and we see the distribution for whichever parameter we select from the drop down box. Once again, we can close boundaries, we set the threshold disorientation angle, and importantly, we can include special boundaries. So I'm adding special boundaries. We have the default cubic relationship here, so 60 degrees around 111, applying to the austenitic ion phase. And it is now recalculated the grain size, but excluding these twin boundaries. And if I switch to the grain click mode, you can see how it is ignoring those twin boundaries when we're selecting individual grains. Once again, we see the grain count, the grain size number down below the grain list, and the statistics relating to whichever parameter we've chosen. We have more parameters that we can measure in AZtecCrystal, and those parameters are selected by clicking on this parameter button here. And we have more ways in which we can display the data. And these would be displayed by choosing the grain display from the map display settings. So we can even display the unit cell orientation for all of the individual grains as picked out in the software. So hopefully this helps you understand how to measure grain size using EBSD, both with AZtec in the data analysis platform and with AZtecCrystal.